If this were a State of the Union address, I think, you know, Cardinal Nation, for lack of a better expression, Planet Red, kind of needs sort of a pep talk and kind of where we are after 2 months. Where are we after 2 months?
Well, I think we're in good shape. I mean, the one thing is the teams are performing like they've always performed. No facilities have fallen down. All the personnel, all the talent's still here. You know, we're dealing with the situation related to the obvious events that occurred a couple months ago quite well. I think we've been proactive, thinking about how we're going to take the program forward. And then I think the most important thing to the fans and the student athletes is we've been engaged, highly engaged with thinking about them, and that rolls right into our donors and sponsors on how we can get them closer to the program and how we can get them more engaged with what our plans are.
For those of us that are not as educated maybe as others, well, maybe some of the harder things about this job maybe that you didn't necessarily anticipate, what have been some of the challenges?
Well, I think it's a different, you know, it's a different audience than when you're running a public company or you're running a large private company. It's, you know, you've got plenty of constituents to deal with, but in board levels, I'm accustomed to that. But, you know, you do have donors and sponsors who also have a voice and a vote in the way things are going. They impact your budget, too, so you got to be thoughtful about that. And that's something, you know, maybe a bit different. And then just time management. You know, I've been, you know, trying to spend my time wisely and try to keep it in balance with the family, but I've got an incredibly supportive wife and Lori that, in terms of my time and my kids, they're old enough now to let me hit all these games and be at all these meetings and go to Fellowship of Christian Athlete dinners and all the things that where I can be visible with all the people here.
Has this been hard?
Not really. I mean, I know that may be a weird answer to say it hasn't been hard. It's what I've done. You know, I've jumped in very complex business situations, you know, most of my career. This has its own complexities. It's certainly not the size that I've been accustomed to, but the complexity is definitely there. When you have many sports and many constituents to deal with, it's there. And then what comes along with it, in many cases when I've done turnarounds on companies, it's because there's problems. And in this case, there are some third-party problems we're dealing with, but you know, that's where my experience can be helpful here is dealing with those issues, whether it be legal contracts, whether it be you know, the situations with the NCAA or FBI. Those are things that I'm more likened to in my past.
The radioactive cloud, for lack of a better expression, the collateral damage of what happened 2 months ago, how have you been able to manage that? How bad has it been? And how do you make it go away without a radioactive cloud lifespan around it?
Yeah, well, I think the thing that's about our fans is they're passionate. And they certainly are going to voice their concerns over what's happened. And I respect that. I really do. I've actually tried to deal with it more one-on-one. I've been trying to be engaging with them, whether it's in the stands or in the parking lots, walking, tailgating. Sponsors I've invited in for one-on-ones. We have a town hall meeting next week with some of our largest sponsors to get them up to speed on what's happening in the program and what I'm up to. You know, I'm the new guy still to them. And making sure that I'm more than just showing up at ball games, but we're making an impact here in the office.
There has been a palpable sense of recovery, maybe for lack of a better expression. Some have been down. There's been like literally steps, I think, through the recovery of all this. Have you felt some of that when you've talked to members of the fan base?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, we all need to heal. You know, I'm a fan, too, as I've said all along, so I try to put myself in their shoes, you know, how I would feel about what's going on and how I would feel about a new guy coming in. I think the difference is that I'm a part of this community. I grew up here. This is all I know, and this is where I've lived, is in Red. And I spent my time playing for Kentucky, but this is all I know. So I'm familiar with the talent in the office. I know the athletic department. I know the donors individually. When I go into meetings, I've known them in the network, in the business network, or in the community. So I think from that side of it, it helps that I already had the community support. And there's going to be fans who don't know who the heck Vince Tyre is and may not even know who my father was here and how involved we were with the program and how I personally was involved from a donor standpoint as well as a fan standpoint. But, you know, that... it's not my intention to bring glory to myself along the way anyways. I'm not about pride of authorship.
What can you tell us about the NCAA investigation, where it stands right now?
Yeah, I mean, I think from the we go down on the previous events. We get to go down on the appeal December 12th and 13th. So I'll be in Atlanta with Dr. Postal and our counsel, and be going through the appeal process. And we're hopeful for a good outcome. You know, as in lieu of the circumstances that everybody knows, we're fighting for the banner and so forth. We've admitted our wrongdoings. We've acted swiftly in trying to deal with those. So I think on that front, we'll know sooner than later. And then on the recent events, there's really no news. I've been up to Indianapolis, met with Mark Emmert and Oliver Luck and their counsel, told them about the proactive things we're doing here. They were very engaged with that. That was on the heels of Commissioner Swofford encouraging me to let the NCAA know what I'm doing, because he's excited about that, as were the other ADs in the conference. I spoke yesterday to Mitch Barnhart about the same things. You know, we talked about, you know, it's common ground here. We have two great universities that have great basketball traditions, and although we deal with different shoe companies, there's common issues out there in the market that, you know, we need to discuss.
The NCAA investigation, what is the sense you get? First of all, what's your opinion about where you guys are? Because there is the concern the banner comes down. Is there a hope that that might not happen?
Yeah, I think there's more than a hope that the banner will come down. I mean, I'm reading it from a outsider. I've read a lot of legal documents in my life. Believe me, when you're doing merger and acquisition, you see plenty of legal documents. Right. And I've read our response. I think it's well crafted. You know, we'll be there to present it. I feel like we've looked at precedent and how things have occurred in the past, how the NCAA's handled it. And I know there's been concerns about inconsistency there. And I'm biased about the inconsistency on how we were handled. But I feel like we drafted a nice response. We'll be down to present it to salvage this banner.
So for those of us that don't understand the play-by-play, you go to meet them for 2 days next month.
That's correct.
And then what happens?
From there, they'll sit back, and that same crew that's hearing our appeal will then come back. They have a time period. I don't know the exact time period. And then they'll come back and issue their final response to us.
And that's it?
And we'll know whether, yes.
And you have no, presuming the worst case scenario, you have no recourse after that. Whatever it is, and that's it.
I think we're prepared for that, yes. And whether there's any damages or related to games and so forth, I think we're prepared for that.
And where do you go from there? Let's assume the worst. And so we'd hear this maybe in January, February, or?
Yeah, I don't know, Fred. I don't know the exact timetable, gotcha. How long they have to in the process to respond to this.
I guess, what is the message? You're almost speaking to yourself. You're part of the fan base.
Yeah.
And, I mean, it's an odd but a unique vantage point, a positive one, in the sense that you can embrace how people feel right now. They don't want that banner to come down. You know, the emotional stakes. You know, there's one opinion that, you know what, Louisville won it. You can take down all the banners you want. We were there. Then there's the other side, which is there's something about something like that hanging there, that if it comes down, it will just be the end of the world.
Yeah, no, believe me, I understand it more than anyone, that we pride ourselves on championships, and they're hard to come by. It takes a lot of talent, and it takes a lot of luck to get there, too. And I think these kids work their butts off to win that championship, and as did Coach and the staff. And, you know, we're doing everything we can to protect it. We feel like we're in the right, that it shouldn't come down. I'm not saying they're not going to try to chase games on us and things like that, and what we may have earned in the process, whatever. But one thing we earned in our mind was that championship, and we deserve to keep it.
Is there a concern there will be another NCAA investigation because of the federal investigation?
Well, I think the likelihood is there would be one anyways. And they're probably, I think the NCAA formed the commission, their coalition there with Condoleezza Rice, because of that. They need to look into this. They need to understand it. They're aware there's an issue in the AAU basketball arena and how it works with the NBA and the Players Association related to the one and done. So I think they're looking at both sides of the, you know, of where we sit in the middle, right? We got one side is the amateurism on one side, and then we got the professionalism on the other side, and we're right smack in the middle of it. And I think they're doing the right thing by, at least on that front, being proactive, while the, because that's, you know, traditionally they're on a reactive sense, but at least they're forming the commission. I think their intentions are good. And then we'll see where it goes from the FBI. They are unaware of the facts as much as we are, that's for sure.
Gotcha. If you were king for a day, is there a way to fix this business model? Because I think that people can generally agree on one thing, is that the business model is broken in college basketball.
Yeah, I mean,
how do you fix it?
Yeah, it's a difficult one to fix because there's two different parties you're dealing with on both sides of it. So you have to get them to agree as well. I think getting the owners and the players association to agree on one thing, you know, and the one and done is the hot topic. I think there'll be a venue for us to place our voice in that. You know, I would expect that there'll be change there. I don't know that it'll be as nice of, if you will, the baseball side, as everybody calls it, where you're 3 years before you go. It may be somewhere in between is where it falls out. But I do think that there's a concern on how the AAU, the amateur side of sports is running, and how these kids are well taken care of before they ever get here to be well taken care of. And I think how they regulate that is going to be the key.
The number you keep hearing is 2 years, that would improve the situation. How do you feel about that?
Well, I take it over the one, for sure. But I think the idea is under the two and done that they have an opportunity to go out of high school as well.
Right.
I think that's the other piece that's getting thrown around. And really, we're only talking, there's been an average, I think, 11 kids that would be potentially, that would probably fall in this range, so call it 10, that would likely be capable of even going from high school to the pros. And the problem is there's these other characters in our business that
right.
are probably telling 100 kids they're the 10.
Right.
And I think that's part of the issue then lies, you know, right there, the problem.
The footprint that's happened here over the last 20 years, you talked about Coach. What do you think Rick Pitino's legacy is here?
Well, I think championship basketball. I mean, we competed, you know, getting to Final Fours, winning a championship. You know, I hate that the tail end of the legacy has a you know, if you will, a bit of a taint on it. But I think he, you know, represented winning basketball. He's a Hall of Fame coach. He's done did a lot of great things in his time here. And look, I know he feels the same. It's unfortunate the way the ending came. But I would certainly respect the wins and the amount of players that came through here. How he developed those players, Russ Smith and many others. I know that's one of his trophy players that we all loved as a player here. And you have to respect that.
The guy that sat in that office that you now sit in, the legacy of Tom Jurich after 20 years being here, what do you think that is?
Yeah, I think it's still around us. I think people respect the 20 years that Tom put in here and how things were developed here. You know, we've had a great legacy of athletics here before Tom with Bill Olson and going back all the way to Pick Hickman. And I'm respectful of that because of my knowledge and my legacy with this program.
Right.
But I'm also appreciative that, you know, things change. TV money changes, conference money changes. You have the opportunity to do great things, and I think what Tom did is great things in terms of building the facilities that we have. And now we have to upgrade some of them. It doesn't stop. I mean, these things need to continue, and it is an arms race, as many say, with facilities and how you recruit. And, mm-hmm. and in my terms, how do you win all ties? And for these kids that come in here, know they're going to be supported academically as much as facilities is what's important to me.
You've been very successful in business. Obviously, you strategically plan. Where do you see this department and this school being in 5-10 years down the road from where it is now, especially given everything that's happened the last few months?
Yeah, I don't see a change in our approach. I don't see a change in our expectations. And I mean that from the sense that our approach to developing these kids and attracting the top talent, attracting the top coaches, our expectations to win with David Padgett are the same as they were with Rick Pitino. We want to win the NCAA this year. And our fans expect to compete for the NCAA championship. I'm not letting those change at all. Those expectations are the same for me as they were with Tom or with Rick. And I say that for as much today we're announcing our new lacrosse coach, it's to win a national championship. If we couldn't find one that could win a national championship, they wouldn't be here. And I think we look at that across all the sports. I think that's the championship mentality that's been developed at Louisville and that I'll foster going forward.
Will you consider David Padgett to be the permanent basketball head coach?
Yeah, I think that he has to be. I think he'll be one of the candidates, and I hope he makes that decision incredibly difficult because we're going to go so far in the tournament. I hope we win that national championship. He's certainly got a lot of emotional fan base behind him, and our role was to try to find the best coaches we could to support him because it's the first time for him coaching. And, you know, I feel like my first recruiting job was Trent Johnson. You know, working with Trent and with David
yes.
was to get
yes.
a really veteran coach who's taken three different schools to Sweet 16, convincing him this is a place where he could add a lot of value and develop his own career. I mean, this is something for Trent as well. It's just in a assistant role, not a lead role, but he's playing a big role. And then Greg Paulus, the next one, which I love to have a lot of fun with, he's terrific. His energy has been great. His winning approach, toughness, is what the team needs and will need, because you know, my voice will always be about get the damn rebound.
I understand, and all the levels to that.
Yeah.
The future of Bobby Petrino. There, once again, are rumors. Successful coaches get those kinds of things. Where do you sit on Bobby and his future here?
Yeah, I'm excited about Bobby. You know, Bobby and I have a good working relationship. We've talked about that. You know, I'm here to promote his success. He's got a contract in place that I have no interest in even discussing. I think I want to do everything I can. My role as a chairman of the board in the past has been to make the CEO as successful as I can and what they need resource-wise and where I can help. If it's helping with recruiting, if it's helping with developing as coaches in a business way or professionally, and certainly engaging with these kids, I'm doing that today, and I'll do that going forward. I'm happy to see the way things turned around in the middle of the season. I think it says a lot for his leadership and our coaches.
Yes.
But we also got healthy. And Bobby he's been great about avoiding, you know, pointing to injuries and different things that have gone on. And
right.
I think people, while they're picking on the defense, I mean, we had a tough go of it for sure. But
yes.
I think everyone got healthy, and it's amazing the turnaround we've made.
The future of Vince Tyrick, month to month.
Yeah.
But do you want that job permanently?
Yeah, I think the thing I've tried to do that is, you know, let that decision work out with the coaches. I think they need to feel that I can add value to them and to their programs. I think the school, as much outside the athletic department, you know, my view is to try to bring balance to the foundation, the university, and to athletics. And I know that people are excited about the positive change after some tough situations in
right.
the foundation. I was a part of that turnaround.
Right.
And then on the university, the similar. People are excited about getting our accreditation back. And I think that in athletics, it's a little bit of the holy land here in Louisville, so you have to be careful when you start looking at making change. But change was needed, and in regards to what someone's having there, the amount of change is debatable, but we're moving forward. And I think if I can add value to that and they feel like it's the right spot, you know, that's worthy of consideration.
Oh, you got a smile on your face.
Well, I'm having fun. You get positive feedback in this job every single day. The kids make you feel young. There's plenty to do here, and you can get plenty of there's challenges, but there's plenty of positive reinforcement that make you want to come back early in the morning.
And it's different than being chairman of the board of a company. I mean, there is a different.
Yeah.
Right.
No, there is a difference when you're chairman. You're setting a different standard and what's your role. You want to be helpful without being intrusive. That's my role to the coaches, is to be helpful without being intrusive. But at the same time, I got a board to report to, and the EULA and the Board of Trustees, and I got to work and be collaborative with them to be successful.